Shariff Kabunsuan's life and mission, reflections and challenges. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله الحمد لله الذي علم بالقلم علم الإنسان ما لم يعلم والصلاه والسلام على رسول الله وعلى اله الاطهار وعلى اصحابه الاخيار. Respected elders and distinguished visitors, active organizers, fellow teachers and dear students, sisters and brothers, ladies and gentlemen, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. May the peace, blessings and mercy of God be upon you all. Let us begin this visitation of the past with a quotation of beauty and try to end the journey by a quatrain of beauty. The quotation is, "Wallah ma ra'aytu illa jamila." That is, by God, I have seen nothing but beauty. Before I tell you whose quotation is this and in which context he or she uttered it, allow me to take a cursory glance at the world of the 15th century, the approximate period of Shariff Kabunsuan's coming to Maguindanao. In the words of an autodidact writer, and I quote, "The vastness of America was then lorded over by thousands of indigenous tribes or nations that we have now collectively known as Indians. In Europe, Russia had been building up its empire at the heels of a newly fallen Byzantine hegemony. In Rome, this period witnessed violent rivalries and disputes in the papacy, only subsiding at the accession of Pope Martin V. The Dutch, the Spanish, the English, and the French and the Portuguese were then each tending its own empire, now at peace and threatening war with each other. The Muslim world by then were broken up into many kingdoms, each set up not by right, but sheer might. The most pathetic quarter at every turn was the family of the final messenger. When they read the verse where Allah told the Prophet, قُلْ لَا أَسْأَلُكُمْ عَلَيْهِ أَجْرًا إِلَّا الْمَوَدَّةَ فِي الْقُرْبَى, say, I do not ask of you any reward for it, except the affection for my relatives. The successive rulers in the Muslim Empire took it to mean persecuting the descendants of the Prophet." Unquote. This is the context of the above quotation. As recorded in one of the darkest pages of Islamic history, exactly 1,371 years ago, in the plain of Karbala of what is Iraq today, no less than the grandson of Prophet Muhammad, salawatullahi wa salamuhu alayhi wa ala ali, Hussein ibn Ali and his 72 family members and votaries were butchered and beheaded while the women and children were taken captives. When the head of Hussein ibn Ali was presented as a gift in the court of Kufa, Ubaidullah ibn Ziyad, the governor, mockingly asked Zainab bint Ali, the leading lady of the captives, "What do you think of what you saw Allah do to your brother and his family?" The granddaughter of the Prophet honorably replied, Wallah, ma ra'aytu illa jamila. By God, I have seen nothing but beauty. Sayyid Muhammad ibn Zain al-Abidin, or what we know as Shariff Kabunsuan, was certainly one of the embodiments of this beauty. According to traditional accounts as well as those recorded by some historians, Sayyid Zain al-Abidin, a holy man from Hadramaut, Yemen, went to Malacca and there married into Johor nobility. Out of this union came Shariff Muhammad Kabunsuan, obviously the youngest in a brood, as indicated by the Malay word Kabunsuan, meaning the youngest. Local tradition further tells us that Muhammad and some of his trusted men sailed along the coastal waters of Johor and were finally brought ashore at the Bukana in Cotabato City, where the locals welcomed him and his group. Thereafter, he introduced his religion, married daughters of local chieftains, and laid the foundation of Maguindanao Sultanate. Now, naturally comes this question. What is Shariff Kabunsuan's legacy? As one of his descendants observed, he came quietly and he left quietly. This fact alone is pregnant with hints as to what his mission was when he came to Mindanao. A product of a persecuted yet very important sector of the Islamic community, he could not have brought the fate of his family's tormentors, this other side of the historical Islam, the Islam of brute force and might, and not that of love and right. Yes, he came not with an invasion, but with gentle persuasion. No extant record of his deeds has come to us. When he left quietly, he only left descendants to serve as living commentaries of the message that he brought. His descendants, who naturally and logically assumed the mantle of leadership in mainland Mindanao, have successively laid down the institutions that serve as our guideposts as we were evolving into a progressive Muslim nation among the community of nations. We have the Parwalan, the Maguindanaon Civil Code. We have a system of elaborate culture. We had even a mystical system called Kapagalatala, the spiritual practice of personally discerning the will of Allah, a religious practice with a distinctly Maguindanaon flavor. All of these are sources of education and edification. After this rundown of Shariff Kabunsuan's life and mission, let me share to you some reflections on 1. Hijrah, 2. Blood over sword, and 3. Versatility, and then point out corresponding challenges. One, Hijrah. World history and sociology corroborate that Hijra and the birth of a civilization are almost inseparable. Jewish civilization has been associated with the migration of Prophet Abraham from Ur to Canaan to Egypt and back to Canaan, as well as that of Prophet Moses from Egypt to Canaan. As the birth of Christian civilization, we are informed that Jesus came to his own, but his own received him not. Islamic civilization has been an illustrious example of a civilization founded on the migration of people from one place to another. So was the coming of Kabunsuan in the island, thereby laying down the edifice of a pre-colonial sultanate. The underlying challenge for us is to perform what a renowned Muslim sociologist labels inner hijra. Number two, blood over sword. The tragic event that happened in Karbala on the 10th of Muharram, 11 years after Hijra, was an attempt by the sword to prevail over blood. So was the kingdoms of Spain and Portugal's design of a grand conquest of what was then known as the Spice Islands that led to the fall of Malacca in 1511, among many other things. Yet, what was apparently an escape from persecution turned into an opportunity for propagation, thus depicting the victory of blood over sword. The underlying challenge is for us to contribute in Shariff Kabunsuan's gradual triumph over virtual obscurity. For example, we all know that about our history, there are plenty of books and manuscripts in Dutch language just waiting for centuries in The Hague libraries to be uncovered and deciphered. Is there anyone in this assembly, especially from among the young students, who is willing to go to the Netherlands and study Dutch language and literature basically for this purpose? Is the Bureau on Cultural Heritage willing to support this endeavor? Time will tell. Number three, versatility. Historical chronicles and local tradition suggest that Shariff Kabunsuan was a missionary, trader, teacher, navigator, and political leader rolled into one. In today's parlance, jack of all trades he was. The underlying challenge for us is to be versatile amidst our bifurcated system of education, secular and religious. In other words, the challenge, for example, to our political leaders and politicians is to be familiarized with religious precepts and principles, and of course, to implement them. While the challenge to our religious figures and personalities is to know the basics of political leadership and management. As I have promised to you at the beginning, let us conclude this brief journey with a quatrain of beauty by Sa'di, a world-renowned Muslim poet, while describing the Prophet of Islam, from whom was taken the first name Muhammad of Shariff Kabunsuan. بلغ الأولى بكماله كشف الدجى بجماله حسنت جميع خصاله صلوا عليه وآله صلوات الله وسلامه عليه وعلى آله. He attained exaltation by his perfection. He dispelled darkness by his beauty. Beauteous are all his qualities. Benediction be on him and on his family. I thank you. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.